When we think about our origin as humans and all animals on land today, we often hear a lot about when fish moved to land and how fish are where we came from. But where did the fish come from? Well, that is what we'll be talking about in today's video. The very first fish and what led to this first fish. Today, most people group modern animals into five main categories: fish, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals. But if fish led to the rest of these groups, what led to fish? Well, most modern fish are vertebrates, which is their subphylum. They have vertebrae, backbones, right? And they are also chordates. They are in the phylum chordates. Phylum is a taxonomic category that is larger, broader than subphylum. And so they are vertebrate chordates, chordates with vertebrae. And most modern fish have jaws and skeletons, either cartilaginous skeletons like sharks and rays, or bony skeletons like our own. But early fish lacked jaws and internal skeletons. The earliest fish we find in the rock record are things like conodonts and ostracoderms. Conodonts appear around 520 million years ago, and ostracoderms around 500 to 450 million years ago, depending on which pieces of fossil record evidence you go with. Some argue conodonts are not true fish, making ostracoderms the earliest known true fish. And although these fish lacked jaws and lacked internal skeletons, they did have a bony outer or exoskeleton that helped protect them from other predators at the time, because interestingly enough, in the ancient seas that these fish were evolving in, they were the low guys on the totem pole. There were some major, huge, terrifying predators out there that were invertebrates, which we'll talk about later. But if you are interested in learning more about these crazy invertebrate predators early in Earth's oceans, I will link my video about huge sea scorpions up above. It's a great one. In any case, these guys later led to the two major groups of fish we have today, cartilaginous fish and bony fish. Cartilaginous came first around 450 to 60 million years ago, and then bony fish appeared around 415 to 425 million years ago. And jaws came about in these groups as cartilaginous fish like placoderms and early sharks began to evolve. And this adaptation obviously made them quickly become dominant and very successful because jaws were really beneficial for eating other things. To be clear, most early life were kind of more passive rather than active feeders, doing things like filter feeding and stuff, rather than actively hunting and chomping prey. And over the next 450 million years to today, both cartilaginous and bony jawed fish have diversified into all the groups we know today. Anywhere from sharks to goldfish to whales. I'm just kidding. Don't come at me. Whales is a joke. Whales are mammals. But importantly here, jawless fish did not go extinct. They're still around. And currently on modern Earth, they're represented by two extant or living groups, and these are the lampreys and the hagfish. But where did jawless fish come from in the first place? These were the first fish, maybe not ostracoderms specifically, but something jawless was the first fish. So where did it come from? What did it evolve from? Well, again, like I mentioned earlier, we typically group animals into fish, amphibians, reptiles, birds, mammals, but all of these groups are part of the phylum Chordata. They are chordates, which are animals that most of which have vertebrae, backbones, like ourselves, and like clear heads or clear head and tail regions. And there are a few other criteria we'll talk more about later that define chordates. But these groups of animals are only one part of all of animal life. There are numerous other phyla of invertebrate animals, animals that don't have backbones, like periphera or sponges, cnidaria, things like corals, jellies, arthropods, which include insects and crustaceans, mollusks, things like clams, snails, cephalopods, octopuses, squids, etc., annelids, worm-like creatures, some types of worms, I think other types of worms are in other phyla, brachiopods, bryozoa, which brachiopods are kind of like clams, but not, Bryozoa are, well, I have a video about bryozoans. They're very odd creatures. I don't even know how to explain them, but I'll link the video up there. Hemichordates, which are also hard to explain, and echinoderms, which are also hard to explain. A good example of echinoderms are things like urchins and sea stars. And hemichordates, some of them are like worm-like, some of them are not. Again, they're very odd creatures. Invertebrates in themselves can be very odd. Anything you find like building a reef system or something, they're just very odd, but so cool and so incredibly diverse. But even though there are all of these other invertebrate phyla other than chordata or chordates like ourselves, there are a couple types of invertebrate chordates. Chordates like ourselves, but without vertebrae. These include tunicates and lancelets. And fish are thought to have evolved from lancelet-like creatures. So some type of invertebrate chordate, even if it's not necessarily within the group that lancelets are, the cephalochordata group. Why do we think this? Well, we found multiple examples of organisms in the rock record that are very, you know, fish-like, early primitive fish-like creatures that show up around 530 million years ago and lacked jaws, skeletons, and vertebrae, but somehow were still technically chordates, and therefore might be the closest ancestors to early fish like potentially conodonts and ostracoderms, which show up right after these early fish-like creatures. So what exactly makes these early fish-like animals chordates if they don't have jaws, skeletons, vertebrae, anything that fish now tend to have? Well, one of the major defining features of chordata is the notochord. These fish had notochords even though they didn't have like spinal, like bony vertebrae backbones. So what are notochords? Well, they are elastic, rod-like structures that in humans and other vertebrates act as kind of a precursor to later vertebrae that will form around it, kind of. But these early fish didn't grow vertebrae around the notochord. They retained it through adulthood, through their lifespan. And it acted as really their only somewhat rigid structure for their bodies, and one of the main things, or one of the only things, that really places them in the phylum Chordata, very similar to modern lancelets, which, as shown in the middle image here, also only have a notochord, which is why they're classified as invertebrate chordates. So these fish-like or lancelet-like creatures led to the very first fish on Earth, which eventually led to all the other major groups of animals we think about today. However, what led to these creatures in the first place? Well, that is a question for a future video, because this takes us all the way back to what led to invertebrates in the first place, and how did we finally bridge the gap between invertebrate phyla to invertebrate chordates, and then finally to vertebrate chordates. If you guys would like me to do a future video on this, I'd love to dive into looking into this topic. I find it extremely interesting that our closest invertebrate phyla relatives are hemichordates, like worm-like creatures, and echinoderms, like sea stars and sea urchins and sand dollars and stuff. That seems insane to me, but I'd love to explore that relationship further and maybe do a future video for you guys, so let me know. And with that, guys, thank you so much for watching. I'll see you guys in my next one. Bye.